Welcome to LiveDaf, your online Daf Yomi Shir.
Shalom Aleichem. Welcome back to today's Daf, KEREISOS Daf. Hey, we begin on Daled Amud Beis, four lines from the bottom. Once again, about multiple violations covered under the single category. Omar Rabbi Ila. Rabbi Ila says like this. A fellow is meant to eat Maser Sheni inside Yerushalayim only. However, Ochal Maser, let's say he ate the Maser Sheni outside Yerushalayim. So he takes, a tenth of the crop, he's meant to bring it up to Yerushalayim and consume it there. He did not. He ate it outside. And he ate different types. Some grain, some grapes, some olives. Three different types of Maser Sheni outside Yerushalayim. How many times Malkus does he get? Ochal Maser, Dogon, he ate the Maser of grain, Vesirish, wine, Vyitzer, oil, Lekesh, Shalash. He gets three times Malkus. Why? Each one is a separate violation. Asks the Gemara, but after all, it's covered under the same collective law. Do not eat X, Y, Z. You don't get multiple punishments for one laugh, which collectively covers many variations. Shani, well, here it's different. The Miatri Kura, you have extra psukim to indicate that, in fact, it elicits multiple consequences. Look, Michti, Kasa Rachman, once the Pasuk stipulates, do eat it inside Yerushalayim. Kasa Rachman, Ve'ochata, Lefnei Hashem, Lekecha, you should eat before Hashem in Yerushalayim. Ma'asar Degoncha, Tiroishcha, Vitzarecha. All these types, Bifnim, in, only inside Yerushalayim, which implies, Bachutz, lay outside, not. Why the repetition? To come back and say, do not eat outside. Lamali, the Kasa Rachmana, why bother saying, Loisucha Lecha Besharecha Masa Degoncha, Besharecha Vitzarecha, Lechalik? The Pasuk is telling you, Shemamina Lechalik, to tell you that each one gets its own liability. Ask the Gemara, no, well, if only from the first Pasuk, you wouldn't have an outright love. It would be just, implied, inferred. Yes, here, obviously not there. That's not as powerful as an outright loisase, which triggers malchus. So perhaps that's why the pasuk repeated itself. Not for the reason of differentiating and, right, giving separate, no. Imahu, because if only from that first pasuk, do eat it inside, which infers don't outside, I mean, I would think, if he does it outside instead of inside, he violated the assay, the yes. Inside, which implies no outside. Ava balave, perhaps there's no outright love. Amat lacha, that's why the pasuk had to come around. Let's turn to the next element. Kas rachman lo yisuchal. Look, ma balav, the reason was to apply a love to it. Vadai, love shabachlalos, and still. The good old love shabachlalos. Why are you getting multiple malchus? Im kain, says the Gemara, because once again, if the point was simply to outline the law, name a craw, the pasuk could just say it in general. It already said, don't eat this, that, and the other thing. Do eat this, that, and the other thing inside, which implies don't eat it outside. The pasuk would just have to repeat a partial reference. Do not eat them outside. Why identify each and every item? Master, the gancha, tiroishcha, vitzarecha, lamali, what's that point? For the yichudi, achila, Akol chad v'chad, to apply a separate consequence for each one. Omer b'itzchak, ichal lechem poli v'karmel. Now we shift to a different example of a collective issur which covers many variations. Chadash, the prohibition of eating grain prior to the 16th of Nisan when they offer the Omer, the Milchas Omer, which is comprised of roasted stalks, which they turn into a mincha. So if one eats from the new crop before the omer is offered, he has transgressed the issur of chadash. What if he eats all different types of grain? Omer b'itzcha, oichel lechem, he eats bread. Kali, roasted kernels with caramel. caramel is when it's still moist and popped out of the husk just manually, you know, with your finger. So different forms, different types of preparation. Like a gimel, we'll get three times malchus, one per. Ask the Gemara once again. Isn't it all covered under one collective lav? Because the pasuk says, "V'lechem v'kali v'karmeloi soichlu ad etzem hayom hazeh." So it's just one lav and all different types. Why three malchus? V'ain loikin lav sheh b'chlos. We do not apply malchus separately for items covered under the same collective lav. Shani hach. Once again, here it's different. The miatri kroy because you have an extra psuk. What's extra? Lehem akro lechem. The pasuk could have simply suffice with saying, do not eat bread. And we will learn everything from bread. V'nei lav kali, v'karmelei, we learn the other types from the bread. Why the repetition? To tell you, each one gets its own punishment. Well, it's not so simple. Before you can challenge this suggestion. Learn everything from bread? Mal lechem, shekein es rabba, it's al chalo. Lechem has an advantage over the other ones. You make a proper dough, you bake a bread, you separate the portion for the kain. Some of it doesn't apply to kernels and stalks. So perhaps that's why it has the extra isra of chadash, unlike the other types. Fine. Nichtav kali. Fine, let the Torah just say kali before the omer is asr. Nichtav lechem. And leave out lechem and caramel. B'nei lef mikali, we'll learn the other ones from the kali. No, you can't. Lechem mikali leyasi. You can't learn bread from kali, from the kali yisibayinei, because kali has an advantage. Kali is simply roasted stalks, unadulterated, unchanged, untransformed. It's still in its original form. Perhaps that's why it has isur chadash. Lechem leyisibayinei, as opposed to bread which has been transformed. Karmel mikali leyasi. On the other hand, you can't learn caramel from kali, because maybe kali is unique from the kali in the Shrabba Eitz HaManachis. Kali has an advantage over caramel, because kali is used by Menachis. We find that kali is used for Minchas HaOmer, something unique, something special. Caramel is not used for mincha. Learn the Shabbat Zomonachis. Okay, that option is out. Next option. Lichtav Karmel. Just write Karmel before the Omer is also. And we would learn the other ones from Karmel. B'nei Lav. Lechem. V'kalimine. Ikal Mirprach. Once again, you can challenge that suggestion. Mala Karmel. Shkei Lenishtan V'riyasai. Perhaps, you know what's unique about Karmel? It wasn't transformed at all. No change at all. It is as it was. Fresh kernels. As opposed to the other ones, which did undergo some level of transformation. Even kali was a little bit transformed, it was roasted. You're right, minchad le yalfi. So you cannot learn two from one. Nelef chadim in trein. Fine, so just write two, omit the third one, which we'll learn from the other two. But we have some sort of common denominator. Leave out bread. And learn bread from kali v'karmel. You can refute that as well. Kali v'karmel, this no beinayah. Kali and Karmel has an advantage over Lechem, which has been totally transformed into a new entity, as opposed to Kali and Karmel, which somewhat retained the original form. Maybe that's why they're also. Fine. L'nichtav krok Karmel. Leave out Karmel. V'neilav melechem v'kali. Learn out from Lechem v'kali. Kali mifrach. You can negate that as well. Mal Lechem v'kali. Shkein shrabat sa menachos. Lechem has an advantage because it's used for menachos. Rashi says Lechem aponim. Shtei alechem. Likewise, kali is used for the Omer, as opposed to Karmel, which has no mincha application. Amachar Yitzchak. I'll tell you, leinichtav kro kali, leave out kali, v'neilav from lechem v'karmel. Learn from lechem v'karmel. Ma parchas. How could you negate that? I parchas, if you'll come back and say, malu lechem shkein eshraba, etz al chala. Bread has an advantage, because chiyav chala applies to it. Karmel yuchiyach, Karmel will undo that argument because there's no challah by Karmel. And still, Yisra Chadish applies. Well, if you go back and say, well, Karmel is different than Kali because Karmel is in its original form, intact, as opposed to Kali, which has some sort of Lechem Yechiach. Lechem will undo that argument because Lechem was converted and it still has Yisra Chadish. Hilkach loike de miyater. Oh, we've just discovered the extra pasuk. And that explains why there's an extra malchus per type. Says the Gemara, you're right about Kali being extra. Maybe we can say Kali de miyater, mechaev, chada. Kali, which is extra, unneeded. It's stated to tell you that it has its own punishment. Akulin mechaev chada. But maybe only one chiv on the other two? Because they aren't really extra. Imkain, if it were so, that it's one chiv for kali, and one chiv for lechem and caramel together, nichtav kro lechem caramel v'kali. The pasuk should sequence it differently. First lechem v'caramel, which have its own chiv, both covered under the same chiv, and then v'kali has a separate chiv. Inami yodhi all the way around. Put kali in the beginning, because he's separate from the rest. Nichtav kali, and then v'lechem v'caramel. Amai kasol l'kali b'em. So why do you stick kali right in the middle? Says lechem, and then kali, and then caramel. The pasuk is teaching us. Lechem ke kali. Lechem has the same status as kali. Nechayev. Who be chayev, the same as kali, meaning kali is separate, so is lechem. And likewise, v'karmel, nechayev v'kali. Okay, kali. And just like kali has its own chiv, likewise karmel. Hence we know, if one consumes three types of chadash, lechem, kali, v'karmel, it triggers three separate malchus. Amar b'yani. La'olam. Keep in mind, al tehei gzeira shava kala b'necha. One should never take the concept of gzeira shava lightly. Al tehei kala b'necha. I'll tell you why. Shari pigel. How do we even know that karas applies to one consumes pigel? Echad miguvi Torah. It's one of the fundamentals of Torah. And guess where it learns from? Agzera shava v'leilim deyakosav. Elam agzera shava Torah. Torah does through agzera shava. It's not even an explicit pasuk. What is the agzera shava? Damar Rabbi Yechna. Tony Zavda Bar Levi taught us a drasha. Nemar lahalan v'ochel v'ani yisa. We find by noisar, material that was left over from the carbon, von itzeri carries a sin. We have the lashon avoyna yisa, and amakan we have over here by pigel. But never jachel zmena avoyna tisa, similar expression, we connect. Malal and karis, just like this karis by noisar, afkan karis, likewise this karis by pigel. Amro simay, another example of a fundamental halacha derived from a xereshav. Loyal malti xereshav, akal bay nachshari noisar. Echad mugubi Torah, how do we even know that this karis by noisar? So it's sort of a chain. Derivation, right? We learn pigel from noisa, and noisa learns from shari noisa echem gevay torah v'leilim da'kosav elam gzera shava. Chorus by noisa is also learned from gzera shava. Mai, what's the gzera shava? Mai yolev kodesh kodesh through kodesh kodesh. Ksiv hacha. This is a good ksiv hacha. Over here by the Noiser, it says, Voichla Vanisa, Kes Kodesh Hashem Chilel. Uksiv, Vesarafta Sanoisa Beshki Kodesh. Who? So, Voichla Vanisa Kodesh Hashem Chilel doesn't stipulate that it's Noiser. How do we know it's Noiser? The answer is connected. There we have the word Kodesh in the context of Noisar. Likewise over here, when it says Kodesh Hashem, it's talking about Noisar. So the Pasuk, which mentions Koris over there, is talking about Noisar. So that's how we know. The Vayichal V'nisa Kodesh Hachila V'nichrsa is applying to Koris, is applying Koris to Noisar. And then we extend it over to pigle, as we said before. Amar Abayi, another example of a basic halacha learned from Gzeira Shava. Amar Abayi, Oyel Maltehi, Gzeira Shava Kala Benecha, don't take it lightly. Shari Bitem and Asasai. The Erva, the getting involved with one's daughter, who was born from his non-wife, woman who was forced, possibly involved with, not a wife, so out of marriage. How do we know that it's asur? How do we know that there is punishment of sreifa? Heinin guv v'torah. It's one of the fundamentals of Torah, and it's learned v'ameg zereshav v'leilimda hakosam zereshav. Damar Rava, Amarli, who told me? Rabbi Yitzchak bar Avdimi. Ask Yehina heina liyisur. How do we know that there's isur by bitim anusasai? We connect it to the pasuk that speaks about bas ishta, the daughter of his wife, where it says the word heina, and it says the word heina here as well. That's how we know that a daughter from a non-wife has osos. What about the punishment? And since it says hema in both locations, and over there by Bas Ishta it says zima and there is sreifa, so we apply that here as well. So it says zima and sreifa here as well. And so I learn from Gzeresha. Omar Bashi. Another example of such. Al ti Gzereshova kalabe de chasharim skalim. How do we know that we stoned any skalim? Hayin Guvetar is one of the fundamentals of Torah. V'loylim donakoso velum Gzereshova. It's learned from Gzereshova. The Sanya Nemar Kant Meim Bum. We find by some arayis it says Dmeim Bum. Right? Their blood is on their heads, meaning they're responsible for their death. We find by the fellows involved in all kinds of sorcery, it says, and over there it stipulates death by stoning. Here as well. Malahalam biskila. Over here as well. Afkan biskila. So if one copies the recipe of the fragrant oil that Moshe Rabbeinu made, that triggers a kares consequence. So in what context? Hamafatim as Hashem lilmud. Boy, let's say he's doing it to practice, so that he could, learn how to do it and prepare it for the tzibur. Oh yeah, manas lamoisel tzibur. Or he's actually putting it together, mixing the oil with the fragrant, ingredients, in order to provide it for the public. It's not for himself; it's for the Beis Hamikdash. Potter, but lo sochayev. If he goes in and makes the shemen mishcha for his own personal smearing, he's chayev. Vasach min potter. On the other hand, suppose he actually made Shalom Mishcha for himself, and he used it. Now, applying Shalom Mishcha is its own violation. Right? There's Mefatim, preparing it, and then there's Sach. But ironically, Sach is only if he takes the original, the real, legitimate Shalom Mishcha from the Beis HaMikdash and puts it upon himself. Not so if he smears the oil that he himself prepared. L'vi she'ein chayav en el al sicha Shalom Mishcha, shasam ha'shev v'bat. It's only chayav for applying that original, real Shem Mishcha that Moshe Rabbeinu made. Let's go back and review. Luma boy, oyal manas l'mesel l'zirah potter. If he prepares the Shemen to study its making, to practice, or with the intent of handing it over to the tzibur's pot. Minol, how do we know? Asyum askuntoy, mibim askunto, the k'tiris. We find a similar violation when it comes to k'tiris. Preparing the k'tiris is an isur, if done for private use. And it says Lashon Maskunta in its configuration, in its proportion, in its recipe. We find Maskunta over here by the Shemen HaMishcha. So we compare. Uksivul Gavikteris, since by the Gavikteris it says, Isser is only if you're doing it for personal use. Let's ask Lochem. We learn Lochem with also. Isser is only if you're doing it for yourself. Aval Moisro Letzibor, but if it's for the Tzibor, it's Potter. Got Meshem Menami, same thing with the oil. La Moisro Letzibor is Potter. Fine. Says the Gemara, once you're connecting, but the Hadak Teres, Vinelef Mishem, why can't Teres learn from Shemen as well? In what way? Ma Shemen Kimifatam Chatzoin Potter, like by the oil. If he prepares, half a recipe, he's Potter. It has to be full, complete. Af Teres Nami Kimifatam Chatzoin Potter, perhaps Teres as well. If he does only half a recipe, it should be Potter. Alam Amarava, why did Rava tell us otherwise? That even if it prepares just an amount for daily use, he's also chayiv. K'tiris shepitma chatzoin chayiv. He's only chayiv if he prepares as per a full year's annual quantity of k'tiris. If he does part, half, Rabbi says even k'tiris even, not only if he does a full year's quantity, even k'tiris shepitma chatzoin chayiv, even if he does part of the recipe is chayiv. In contrast to shemen, where it's all or nothing, shepit mechatzon is potter. Why? Why don't we compare? Just like by the shemen, it has to be the full amount. Same with the k'tiris. Amalach, Rava says like this. Rava would respond, Gam shemen k'siv, uv maskunt lo yisasu kamayu. You're not meant to emulate exactly the way it was done then. Don't do it exactly full recipe, but half a part, that's okay. However, by the k'tiris it says k'siv v'k'tiris asher tasa. Tasa means kol asiy the k'tiris, any formulating of Torahs. Even one day's amount. Efshar de makta pras shachrus pras ben arbaim. The fact is that even a small amount is suitable for akrava. Every day they will makter a mana, split into two parts, half the morning, half the afternoon. So it's done piecemeal. And likewise, if he prepares piecemeal, it's also considered a violation. Tan Rabban. Speaking of which, how did they manufacture the Shemen HaMishcha? How much was it? In quantity? What kind of ingredients were included? Tan Rabban. Shemen HaMishcha contained the following. Moir Derer. The Rambam learns that Moir is a type of fragrance which is made of blood of a certain animal found in Eretz Hoidu in India. Some call it musk oil. So how much of that? Moir Derer, hey, maybe it's 500. When we speak about numbers, we're talking about weight of shkolim. So there was a certain weight called a shekel weight, the amount that weighs like a shekel. 500 of that. Kida, a certain root of a plant called Kida, it's also called Ktsia. Once again, Heimei is 500. Kinmon Besem, that's the bark of the cinnamon. Chamishmei is 500. Yoknei Boisem, Chamishim Usaim, 250. So if you count it all up, Nimtzu Kulam, you have Elef, Ushvameus, Chamishim, 1750. I mean, obviously, we'll count it up. Tana, Minyana, Oslash, Kamash, Mondo. Tana is just giving us a tally, counting it up for us. The point is like this. The Tana is making a point. Tana, Kakashi, the Tana really had a kasha. Because how do we know that Kinman Besem is a total of 500? And Knei Baisim is only 250. If you look at the Pasuk, if you have it on the margin, it's very helpful. The Pasuk says like this, V'ata kach l'chor b'samim roish, mor d'ror chameshmei, it's fine. V'kinmon b'asem machatzisoi, half of the total amount that's needed, is chameshim umasayim 250, which means twice 250 for a total of 500. And then, v'knei Baisim also chameshim umasayim 250. Now, does it mean 250 in total? Or 250 times 2, like the previous ingredient. So the Tana wasn't sure. Tana kakashile. Ema, perhaps you can suggest that Knei Baisim was also 250 times 2. Ema Knei Baisim, just like the previous ingredient, Kinman Besim. Ma Kinman Besim ach tzisoy. Chamish Mosam, just like the previous ingredient, half of it was 250, meaning a total of 500. Maybe this one as well is 500. Af Knei Baisim ach tzisoy chamish Mosam. In which case you end up with 2,000 in total. Davla train often. So maybe that's taka true. In Cain, the answer is no. Look closely at the pasuk again. Because if it were so, the pasuk would just bundle it together, both ingredients, because they have the same amount. In Cain, nichtav kro, kinmon besem, and then uknei besem. Both of them, both have the same formula. Half is 250. The pasuk split it up to tell you. Only the first ingredient is half. Half is 250, meaning 250 times 2, whereas the second ingredient is a total of 250, which tallies up to 1750 in total. You know, when you do all these weighings, is it exact, or do you do a little bit, you know, a tip? Tip it a bit, right? That's what's called a tip, when you tip the, because they used to weigh it and tip it a bit, right? And actually, that's the way you're supposed to weigh in a commercial setting. Sadek Mishal Chavah, take them into tip a little bit and give the customer a bit extra. So what happens to measuring the components of the Shemen HaMishcha? Is it exactly, or is it tipped a bit? When he measures up these ingredients, Bechreahu Shekel, does he tip it a bit? Or Yayin Ba'ainu Shekel, or exactly? Omar Lei, of course exactly. Rachmana Omar Ba'ad Devad Torah uses a Lashon of Ba'ad Devad, which is actually by the Torahs, but we compare Torahs to Shemen HaMishcha. It's meant to be with exactness, and you tell him you tip, at Amr's Bechreya. It says the Gemara, but what, how could you avoid the tipping? V'amar vidah, HaKadosh Baruch Hu Yedeh Bechreyes. Hashem pays attention to the tippings. Apparently, he's supposed to do that. Amr, this lu bechreya. Apparently, there's tipping. Elamar vidah. You tip. The kinman basim. Why is it when it comes to kinman basim, the Torah says split it up? What's the point of measuring it twice? The goal is 500. Just do it in one shot. Why is he bringing machsisai of 500? Meaning, chamish masayim b'chadzim once. And then again, chamish masayim b'chadzim. Kibun de kulu, hey, meyos havin. If in any case, you're aiming for 500. Naisi, hey, meyos vasachas. Why don't you do it at once? Shmami, no? Apparently, it's for the tipping. Because each way gets its own tip. Bele de kamais, la kirin besam betrays him. The reason why the Torah instructed us to do it in two stages, Hechrei, is because it has a tip. So each one gets a separate tip. And that's the purpose. In fact, Hashem pays attention to that as well. My bad bevad. So what then does the pasuk mean? Bad bevad, which indicates with preciseness and exactness. Amar Avinu shelayaniach mishkol b'mishkol b'yishkol. The Torah is just saying like this. Bad bevad means that you measure it properly. You weigh it properly. Opposite the weight corresponding to the amount that you need, as opposed to once you weigh up, you know, the first batch of ingredients, you can't use that material, that ingredient, as a counterweight for the next ingredient. It has to be weighed corresponding to the actual weight itself, the metal weight. That's the aloha. Tana Rabba. Fine. So we have the ingredients, we have the amount. What is the procedure? When Moshe Rabbeinu processed the Shem Mishcha, how did he do it? He would soak the roots, the ingredients, in the oil. It was 12 log of oil. First you soak it. How could you offer that type of process? All the oil will be absorbed and gone by the time you turn around. The amount of oil that they used was quite little. Only 12 log. And these ingredients were enormous. So much, close to 2,000 shekel weight of. So even just to smear, to coat the ikar on the plants, you wouldn't have enough oil, let alone end up with actual oil to be used. So what do you do? Ketzadoy, how do you do to avoid losing all your oil in the ingredients? Have you a karn? First you would bring the ingredients, soak them in water, saturate them with water, so that the oil doesn't get absorbed in the ingredients. And then he runs the oil above it. We call it as harayach, which absorbs the fragrance. But then he skims off the oil, which is now fragrant. Amuler Rav Yehuda. Rabbi responds, yeah, according to the laws of nature, you're right, but who's thinking about nature these days? Shem Mishcha was a miraculous phenomenon from top to bottom. Turn to the base. You think Shem Mishcha only experienced one miracle? It was a long string of miracles from beginning to end. Listen to this. You start with only 12 log, which is a relatively small amount of oil. And it was stretched and stretched and stretched. It was used to anoint the whole Mishkan and all the utensils. All throughout the 7 days, they were used for Kohanim Gedolim throughout the generations and kings. And guess what? There's nothing missing. Come, Mashiach times, you'll find it all intact. All 12, look, nothing missing. Apparently, we're talking beyond the laws of nature. Shnemar, Shemen Mishchas Kodesh Yeh, Zelil Dereseichem. Zeh means, numerically it's 12, right? 7 and 5. Bigmatri Beis Lugan Havu. Hashem says, all 12 will be around all the time. And therefore, it's no wonder that they can just soak the ingredients and get away with it. Tanu Rabbanan. Vayigach Moshe Shemen Mishcha, Vimshach Hasam Mishcha. So once again, read the Aymer. Shem and Moshe manufactured in Midbar was full of miracles. You start with only 12 log, which is a relatively small amount for its function. You have to discount the amount that gets absorbed in the pot while it's cooking. How much do the ingredients absorb? How much gets evaporated by the fire? And guess what? It was used for so many purposes. Okay. So he made his point. Now the Brisa continues. In terms of, you know, specifics of when it was used. Even if you have a Kohen Gadol, a son of an existing, of a former Kohen Gadol, so although he's just taking over the dynasty, he needs his own anointment. But not so by a king. By a king, it carries over automatically. A king, son of a king, does not need new Mashiach. He has the mantle, but just by the way of inheritance. So that triggers a question, Vim Taimar. If you will ask, so why did they have to anoint Shlomo HaMelech, who's the son of David HaMelech, who's already anointed? The answer is because it was contested. When it's contested, you have to restart. Because Adonia contested his reign, and that necessitated a new anointment. Another example of such, he had to be anointed, because Atalia was challenging him. Because of Yaakim, because his brother Yaakim, was older than him, 2 years older than him, so he was contesting, and he had to have his anointment to establish his reign. Okay, let's go back and review these halachos. Omar Mar, so when they're appointing a new Kohen Gadol, even though his father was already a Kohen Gadol, the son requires a new Mashiach. How do we know? So the anointed Kohen from his descendants, name a Krova Kohen, Tachtav, Mibanov. Why the word HaMashiach? Just say, you know, his descendant, his son, who takes over the Kohuna, my HaMashiach. What's the added word Mashiach? Kamash want to teach us. Tafil Mibanov. Even if the Kohen Gadol left over a son who's taking over, how would the Mashiach have a Kohen Gadol? The son gets anointed anew. He gets the status of Kohen Gadol, otherwise we have Kohen Gadol. So Kohen Gadol always needs Mashiach regardless. But not so by a king. Amamar, a Mashiach Melech HaMelech, a son of a Melech does not need new Mashiach, unless it's contested. Minol, how do we know this is true? Amar Rach Bar Yaakov Dechsev Laman, Yarachim HaMamachtei. Hu Vanav. So Malchus carries over automatically Yerushi. So that triggers a question. Mipnei Ma Mashiach Shloimai. So why does Shlomo HaMelech need his own Mashiach, despite being the son of David HaMelech? Nay, Machlekes Adonia, because he was challenged by Adonia. Menol and the Chiyas, Machlekes. Boy, Mishnah, how do we know that's true, that when there's Machlekes, you need to reestablish it with a new anointment? Rather than just saying, well, any king could just pass on the Yerusha to his son, Amrapav, Amakro, Beker of Yisrael. This pasuk, that Leman Yaruch Yomav, which tells you that Malchus carries over, that's only Beker of Yisrael when it's agreeable to all. There's man shalom be strong in this peace and tranquility. But when there's machlokes, there's conflict, and his leadership, his status is contested, you have to reestablish with a new anointment. Tana, we have another example. Af Yehu ben Nimshi, he as well, le Nimshech. The only reason why he was anointed el bnei machlokes is Yoram Manacha, because he was challenged by Yoram. Ask the Gemara, well, in any case, he's a first, he's not a son of. Amai, why do you have to come on to this reason? Typically, the Melech Rishonu, simply because he was the first in the family. Chasur Mechel Ketoni, the bride is missing. And you read it like this. We meant to know Malchabe is David Nimshmoishchen. The only ones who were entitled to be anointed by the Shabbat Mishchah was the Malchus, based David. But Malchabe Yisrael, the other kings, not from David Melech's family, ain't Moishchen. We do not apply Shabbat Mishchah. They don't deserve Shabbat Mishchah. It's not for them. So then, so why did they anoint Yehu, who was not from Malchus Beis David? The answer is because he was contested. And Achleik is of Yerem ben Achav, and the world will ask later, well, is that a reason to use Shemar Mishcha, which is holy oil? You're not meant to use it. Out of line. We'll get to that in a minute. Amamar, Malchus Beis David Moishchin. We only Moishchin Malchus Beis David, but Malchus Beis Yisrael. Now, how do we know? The Chesiv, Kum Shachayuk is Zehu. Hashem tells Shmuel Navi, go and anoint David, right? Only him. Kizehu. We learn Zeto on Mashiach. Only him and the likes of him. David Melch's family is Torah and Mashiach, requires Mashiach. Ein achat Torah Mashiach, but other kings, Malchus Yisrael, not from this family, do not, are not entitled to Mashiach. Omar, so what do we say? The reason why we were Mashiach, Yehu, despite him being from Malchus Yisrael, was because he was challenged. Omar, Mechlek is Yoram. Is that justification to misuse the Shema Mashiach? Because he was challenged by Yoram, Nimoil b'Shemen HaMishcha. We're going to misuse Shemen HaMishcha because our Papa, the answer is that our Papa tells us later, it wasn't the original Shemen HaMishcha, it was a copy. But Farsim HaDachid, they used pure persimmon oil as a substitute. Chanamir as well, it wasn't the original Shemen HaMishcha, it was Farsim HaDachid. Who else? Vesya Yachas. Who was the son of Yeshua Melech, right? Bnei Yoyakim. He was anointed because he was being challenged by Yoyakim, who was older than him. Shai Yagadu Menem, Shteishan, was 2 years older than him. Really? Umi Kashish? Was Yoyakim older than Yoyachas? You look at the Pasuk, it seems otherwise. It seems like Yoyachas was older. Voksiv, the Pasuk enlisting the sons of Yeshua Melech, Bnei Yeshua, says like this, Abachar, firstborn was Yoyachanan. Who we're going to see in a minute is actually Yoyachas, one and the same person. So he was number one. Hashen Yoyakim, the second one online is Yoyakim. He was younger. Hashlishi was Sitkiyo. Haravi Shalom, who we're going to learn in a minute, were the same person. Vamarabi, oh, Rabbi Yechanan. Who Yoyachas, who is Sitkiyo? Yoyachas and Sitkiyo. Vamarabi. Vamarabi. Rabbi explains that Yoyachanan, who Yoyachas, the first son, the first name of the Pasuk Yoyachanan is really Yoyachas. So he's the oldest. And then we have another pair up, Tzidkiyo, who Shalom. 3 and 4 in the Pasuk are really the same person. Tzidkiyo and Shalom are the same person. He had multiple names. In any case, it would seem that Yoyachas was older, not Yoyakim. Ela lo'ilam Yoyakim Kashish. No, truthfully, Yoyakim was older. Why was Yoyachas, a.k.a. Yoyachanan, called a Bachar? Shebachar l'machos. Because he was first to the kingship. He preceded Yoyakim. That's why he's listed first in the Pasuk. Ask the Gemara, why would they appoint a younger brother before the older? Umi mokminoi, zuta, kamikashish. Do they then do that? Appoint a younger one before the older one. But still, we find elsewhere that it was given to the older son, because he's the oldest, Yabachar. So why was this different? The answer is, because in our case, Yoyachas was more deserving of assuming his father's mantle. He would step into his father's shoes in terms of his level of righteousness. So that's why he got priority over his brother, despite the fact that he was a bit younger. Amar, who's Shalom? Who's Tzidkiyo? So numbers 3 and 4, Shalom and Tzidkiyo are one and the same person. Asks the Gemara, how could you say it's the same person, but the Pasuk lists them as separate? One son, another, a third, and a fourth. But with Dari Kachash, we have four daras, four, you know, sons. Answer is, Umay kar de shlishi, shu shlishi lobanim. The fact is, number 3 and 4 are really one and the same person. The reason for calling him number three, is because he was in fact the third son. My card the reveal. Why was he called number 4? Not because it's a fourth person. It's the same person. She revealed Lamalchus. Because he was actually the fourth king in the family. So after the father Yeshio, we have Yechanya. Sorry, we have Yoyachas, who was Yeshio's son. Then we have Yoyakim, who was a brother of Yoyachas. Then we have Yoyakim's son, Yechanya, and then over to the uncle, back up to the uncle, Tzidkiyo. So Shalom, a.k.a. Tzidkiyo, was really one and the same person, but he was the fourth king of the family, because his nephew preceded him. Because Yechanya, who was his nephew, preceded him in terms of kingship. But Malach Yoyachas, after Yeshua, Melach came Yoyachas, a son who took over, like we said. And then next, on the list, Vahada Malach Yoyakim, and then Vasef Malach Yechaniah, who's Yoyakim's son, and then back up to the uncle, Vasef Malach Tzidkiah. Tana Rabban, who's Shalom with Tzidkiah? So Shalom is the same as Tzidkiah. Why these names? Vahama Nikash Mai Shalom, why was he called that? Shay Shalom myself. He was complete in his ways, he was fully righteous. Davarach, another reason, Shalom. Shalom Malchus David Yamav. He's the last king of the David dynasty. So Shalom in this case means completion. He was the last on the list. Umashmoy, what was his real name? Matanya Shmoy. Shenamah, we find that Nebuchadnezzar appointed him king. Shenamah Vayimlech Vayamlech Melech Bavel Es Matanya Doide Tachta. So Matanya is Sitkia, who is Shalom. He was Yechaniah's uncle, and he was appointed by Nebuchadnezzar as king. He told him, look, you're committing to me with an oath to stay loyal, right? Hashem should apply judgment to you if you rebel. We find that he brought him to Babel when in fact he rebelled. He rebelled against the Mashiach B'Yabu Kim, the one who imposed an oath on him. Ask the Gemara, we have a Shevan HaMishcha. Did we then even have Shevan HaMishcha in the time of Yoyachas, who we said was anointed because he was contested, because he was coming before his brother? But it seems like they didn't even have access to the Shevan at that point. It was already hidden, out of sight. V'atani v'av b'raisa, that the father, Yeshua HaMelech, hid everything, including the Shevan HaMishcha. It was inaccessible. V'atani v'shenignas aron, the same time that the Arayin, which contained the Luchais, was buried and put away for safekeeping until Mashiach will come. Nignas, since it is Haman, along went with the Arayin, went the container with the Man, which was placed alongside the Arayin for display to future generations that Hashem is the ultimate provider of our sustenance. We need just do as told, learn and daven and a little shtadlus, and Hashem will provide the rest. So that was also taken away with Lech Hashem and Amishcha. There you go. Umakle shel Aaron, shkedel v'rocheha, and the famous staff of Aaron HaKohen, which sprouted forth nuts and almonds and blue blossoms to show that, in fact, he was appointed and chosen by Hashem. V'argas, so all these items had been placed alongside the Aaron and were hidden alongside it. And what else? V'argas sheshigur plishtim doyrin l'kei Yisrael, and also the chest, the beautiful chest that the plishtim sent along when they had taken the arayin away, and then they returned it when they were being punished. They sent it with a nice gift. So all that was sitting alongside the arayin. Shnav v'eskol v'esklei hazov v'asher shivoysim loy ashom tasim v'argas mitzidoi. So the pasuk they were speaking about the fact that they sent the golden items with this chest alongside the Arayin. So whatever happened to the Arayin, the chest shared its fate. And who put away all these items? Umi Gnozoi, Yoshia, Melach Yehuda Gnozoi, he did it, Shnemar, Vayim Alavim, he turned to Levim, Avim, Kol Yisrael, Kodeshim Hashem, he says, Tzunus Aron Hashem, let's find a good hiding place for the Arayin with all its accessories until the redemption time. So that's not taken away to Bavel by the Goyim, right? So not only the Arayin, but also all these items. How do we know? Amar Belazar, As Yasham Sham. Because we find the Lashon Sham by the Arayin. It says Shama. We find by the container of the Man. It's in Shama. So it was situated alongside the Asya Doris Doris, we find by the Shem and the Mishra as well, that it's connected to the Arayin, because by the Mon it says Doris Seichem, by Shem and Mishra it says Doris Seichem, so it shares the same faith, by Asya Mishmeres Mishmeres, and regarding the staff of Arayin, by the Mon it says the Mishmeres, by the Mati Arayin it says Mishmeres, so basically we learn that they all were strung together, so to speak, and share the same faith, and were placed at the same location. So back to the question, how did they have access to Shevan HaMishcha to anoint Yoyachas, who came later? Amar Papa, oh, Ba'afar Sama Dachia Persimon oil was used instead. Tan Rabba. So we spoke about the recipe of the Shevan HaMishcha, the process of making it, who they would apply it to, and now how? So it really depends. Kings are anointed in a crown-like formation, so they would drip some of the oil around the top of the head like a crown. But the Kohanim were different. As the Kohanim came in key, they would apply it like a letter key. Key is a Greek letter called key, some say it's like an X. So they would put some oil on his head, between his eyebrows, and then run it like an X over the forehead. Tanichad. So how did they do the application on the Kohen Gadol? So one Brisa says, first they would drip some on the head, then they would spread it manually between the eyebrows, as explained. Another Brisa, at first they apply it manually, then they drip it on the head. Only then they drip it on his head. Explain like this. So the second opinion holds, and the third opinion holds, Meshicha means the manual application, that stands higher, that takes priority, that goes first. Meshicha adifos, the smearing goes first, and then you drip. And the other shita says, no, it's adifa, the dripping goes first, that's preferred. Why? What's the reason for that? My time. Demand amar it's adifa, why do we hold that the dripping would take priority? Why is that first? Shenamar, because look at the pasuk. It's stated in that order. Vayitzek Meshem Al Mishchal Roish Aaron. First he drips, and then it says Vayimshachoy. So he would smear it. Uman Dam Meshicha Adifa. The other shita holds that Meshicha comes first. The Kosava he holds Shkinis Rabbi Itzak Leisharis. Because true in terms of Aaron the Kohen Gadol, they would drip it and smear it. But smearing was the only process used by Kleisharis, because over there it only says Mashachta. So you see, Meshicha has an advantage. It's used all around. So that would go first in the process. Voksiv Vayitzek. But in this pasuk by the Kohen Gadol, it says Vayitzek, which sounds like you drip first and then you smear. The pasuk is meant to be learned a bit differently. Reverse it. Matam Vayitzek. Why would he drip it? Because he already smeared it. Mishum Vayimshach Hayse Lekach. Turn around. Speaking of the Shana Mishum. Kshemar Tevel Rish. The pasuk on Tehillim. Describing this fragrant oil dripping down on the head, the Yerid Al-Azok, and down on the beard, on Aaron HaKohen's beard. Says the Gemara is an interesting phenomenon. Margolius. It was two like pearl-like drips, droplets of this oil, which were permanently present in Aaron HaKohen's beard. When he would be mesaper to Pshat Marash, either he would be conducting a conversation and was concerned that perhaps the oil would fly out, or another Pshan Rashi when he would trim his beard. So what would happen? So these droplets would miraculously travel up to the base of the hair of his beard. And on account of this, Moshe Rabbeinu was concerned, perhaps I put too much oil, I deviated, I was moyel, by putting too much on Aaron HaKohen. Yotze Baskel of Arma comes out a heavenly voice and says, don't worry, Katal Cherman, Sheyared Al Haritzioin, the Shemen is compared to the dew on the mountains. Matal, anybody Me'ilah, just like no Me'ilah on Udu of Shemen, Sheyared Al Kan Arne, Me'ilah is no Me'ilah, don't worry about the oil situated on his beard. But Aaron, still, Aaron HaKohen is concerned. V'amar, he's saying, Shema Moshe L'maya, true. Hashem put Moshe at ease, no concerns. But maybe I have enjoyed the Shema Mishcha, your fragrance has spilled over to my clothing. Ani Ma'alti, maybe I went too far. Yotze Baskel V'amar, once again, a heavenly voice calls out, not to worry. You have the same status as your brother Moshe Rabbeinu, you're free and clear. Both brothers as one. Just like no Me'ilah concerned by Moshe Rabbeinu. Don't worry about Me'ilah as well. Turn around. He meant to anoint the kings near a spring, which is a good omen, a good sign of fresh running water, which symbolizes the durability, continuity of the kingship. So this is David HaMelech telling them to bring Shlomo HaMelech down to Gicha, into the spring, and over there you'll anoint him. That was a good siman, a good place for anointing a king for successful malchus. Okay, speaking of which, Amar Rav Ami, Haiman the boy laid a moshkashat eloi. Speaking about the omens and signs, a person would like to know whether he will live through the year. Maisi shroga, let him get a hold of a lamp, a candle, Bahalein Asur Yayin, during the Asur Simei Tshuva, the Bein Rishata, between Rosh Hashanah and Kippurim, Vidital Vibes Lunch of Zika. Hang it up, light it in a room, a windless room. Vimashach Mahirei. So in fact, the flame burns on until it depletes the entire oil. Then he knows he'll have a safe year. Neither the Masak Shait. Uma the boy Navid Iska. Likewise, if a person is embarking on a new business opportunity, he wants to know whether it's a good idea, whether it will be successful. Uboy Dinaid, he'd like to know in his business, and Rabbi Tarnagoy should raise a chicken for this purpose and see if it gets nice and plump and healthy. Oh, he knows he'll be successful. Ish Shaman Ashfar, if it'll come plump and good, looking good, Nay the muscle, and he knows the business venture will succeed. Haiman the boy Nevek Boruch. Likewise, a person is embarking on a trip. Uboy Dinaid Yodel Basi would like to know whether he'll make it back home safely. Neil Nakum Basi, go ahead and stand in a room, the Bahasa, in a slightly dark room. Ichaz, we turn to the next topic. Ichaz Bevoy Le Bevoy. He notices a double shadow. So we have the primary shadow, we have like a secondary hazy shadow. Some actually say it's the electromagnetic field surrounding a person. So if he sees that extra field, that extra shadow, Bevoy Le Bevoy, Neda De Os Le Beise, then he knows he'll come back home safely. Vlam we'll see. The more discourages this practice, and some say it refers to all the practices we discussed, because Vlam Milsi, Dilma Chol Shadayte, might turn out that it won't look good initially, and his mood will drop, and that will, and that can actually have a detrimental effect on his mazel. The happier the person, the more positive the person, his mazel strengthens, but he's discouraged, and that itself could be, chas v'shalom, a catalyst to less than good things. Chol shadayte, his das will be weakened, his mood will drop. U'mishu mazel, his mazel can get weakened. But now that we've learned that the concept of a simon is something of substance, something that has meaning, something real. Therefore, on Rosh Hashanah, a person should engage in activities and eating items which symbolize positive things. A person should accustom himself that Rosh Hashanah should eat the following items. And Rashi explains some of them are very sweet, some of them grow quickly, so they're symbols of success, prosperity, and atzlach. Chara, that's a pumpkin. Eruvia, some sort of plant called tilson. Karsi, leek, silka, beets, vitamri, and dates. Some farshim learn. The point of the Gemara is not that, you know, you just eat it and automatically have a good year. The point is the opposite. You're meant to connect to these items and say, look, relate to the special qualities and apply it to oneself. That's what we say, yiratzen. It's not automatic. You eat it, just the opposite. Yiratzen, Chafetz Chaim Mishnah Berurah brings. He points out that it's not just abracadabra. You have to say the tefillah and commit to a personal transformation in one's own life, to get going, to get excited, to get serious about good things, which is triggered by going ahead and eating these things and internalizing their lessons. Okay, further on the topic of a simon, Omali of Mersharsha, he turned to his sons, Levnei. When you're going to learn by your Rebbe, do as follows. Kibbe Yisu, when you're wishing to go in, Lamezel, to go, Lamigmar, to learn Kamei, Rabchim, before your teacher, do as follows. Prepare yourself properly. And first learn the Mishnayos, the materials, and then when they go into your Rebbe, where you will gain a deeper understanding of the material that you've prepared. Next, when you sit in front of your Rebbe, keep an eye on him. Be cognizant of his facial features, his facial expressions. Watch his mouth. You'll see his expressions, and that adds to your understanding of his teachings. And when you sit down to learn, groisu al maya, do it near water, near a river. Just like the water flows, timshech shmaitzchein, your learning will grow and develop and be successful. What else did he tell them? You should live akilku de mata machasya. Better sit on the garbage dumps of mata machasya and live a simple life rather than the palatial homes of Pumbadisa, Vilaya Padni, rather than the mansions of the Pumbadisa, who are dishonest people. Keep away from their company. In terms of diet, Tav, it's better to have gildon, small fish, sario, which is about to spoil, not so fresh. Better to eat that. Lamechel to eat. Mikutcha de rami keeper rather than kutach, which is like a spicy dip, which can crack the keeper, the boulders, meaning less spicy, less seasoned. Simple food is healthier. But this Palul Chanav HaTaymer, she davened to Hashem and expressed gratitude. Allah, Tzlibi Hashem, I'm so grateful to Hashem. Romo Karni, my horn has risen. Something related to a horn, which denotes success. Romo Karni, only that has success. V'loi benad Roma Pachi, something related to a pacha, just a container, isn't that successful. What does that mean? So her son Shmuel anointed some kings, right? David HaMelech was oil coming from a horn versus the anointment of a shawl, which was from just a pach. And we see a difference. David Shlaim, Shem Shchol B'Keren, they got their oil from a keren, which denotes strength, right? The keren is an expression of strength of an animal. It's also shaped that way, like stretching, and denotes longevity and endurance. Their machus endures forever, as opposed to shol v'yehu. Shnim shechu min ha-pach, they got the oil from the pach. Linu shemachusam, their machus wasn't as enduring and not as successful. Okay, so we see the chashivas of simonim in certain times, in certain contexts. Okay, back to the beginning of the daf. Spoke about two examples of multiple variations of Isser, which I technically cover under the same law, but generate their own consequence. We have the three types of Maser Sheni, we have the three types of Chodesh because of the extra Psukim. We have four examples of the importance of Gzeira Shava. We went about Fatim Misa Shemen, for personal use is Chayev. Applying Shem Mishcha is Chayev as well, if it's the original Shem Mishcha which he's using. We learned about the ingredients contained in the Shem Mishcha, the process of making it, the Rav Yossi's approach, Rav Yehuda's approach. We have a list of nisim that occurred to the Shem Mishcha. We learned about who the Shem Mishcha is applied on. We spoke about the Melech Ben Melech, typically doesn't need unless it's contested. We spoke about a Farsa Madachia option when there was no longer access to Shem Mishcha. We spoke about the way they apply it. Kimin Nezer, Kimin Ki, spoke about Moshe Rabbeinu Aaron HaKohen regarding their concern about the Shem Mishcha, which was not, which the Pasuk, put them at ease about. We spoke about doing the Mashiach Alamayan and learning Torah alongside the water, which is a siman for success and Hatzlach. All the best to you and Hatzlach Rav.